You're listening to the AfterBuzz TV Network, now the largest new media platform on the web, and your number one source for after-show entertainment. Very good,
Johnson. AfterBuzz TV. AfterBuzz TV.
From the AfterBuzz Studios in Los Angeles, California, presented by Maria Menounos and Bing.com, and streaming live thanks to Akamai Technologies, this is AfterBuzz TV's Rookie Blue After Show. We'll break down tonight's episode and get you all the latest news and gossip. And now, another post-game wrap-up show for your favorite TV show. It's AfterBuzz TV's Rookie Blue After Show.
Hello, everyone. Welcome back. Yeah. Rookie Blue, it's back on the air. There's our music. Here it is.
This is the good life.
Yeah, it is the good life. Bing is for doing, and we are here doing another AfterBuzz TV after show for our favorite show and yours, Rookie Blue, Season 4, Episode 4, The Kids Are Not All Right. Not to be confused with the movie, The Kids Are All Right. Anyways, I'm I'm your That's all I could think about the whole episode.
That's a great movie too, so.
It is, right? Mm-hmm. I'm your host, Tiona Hobson, and joining me tonight, I've got three awesome chicks, all chick panel, doing a cop show. I love this. Yeah. I'll let them introduce themselves.
Hi everyone, I'm Marisa Serafini.
Hi, I'm Anik Dufour.
And we've got a very special guest who I'll let Marisa introduce.
Yes, we have a special guest on the couch, my good friend, good college friend, Cindy Navarro. What's up, Cindy?
Yay. Thanks for
having me
come here.
Thanks for coming.
My bad.
There you go.
There it is.
Say hi, Cindy.
Hey.
Cindy's a big fan of the show, so she watched the episode with us just now, and she's here to give us her outsider's input into all of our thoughts of what's going on with everything on this show. So let's talk about the crime. So, you know, it starts off pretty fast with, you know, the night before there was a high school student shot and killed. His name was Richie. And we have Swarek, who's, you know, the lead detective and has everyone looking out for. Did anyone catch the kind of car? Because all I got was that it was red and black. Because as soon as you start talking car to me,
I'm the exact same way. I'm like,
I didn't catch
the sports red car.
Yeah.
All right. Some fancy car.
I felt like this might be important to remember, but every girl part in me just went like, glossed over eyes.
It went over your head.
As soon as the car started being talked about, it was like, blah, blah,
I just
blah.
Thought of like Tokyo Drift. That's all I kept thinking. Like, oh, that's a cool, cool car you would see like in Fast and Furious or something. And then I just got distracted.
Thinking about all the hot boys in Fast and Furious.
Yes, exactly.
That's what happens to me too. So Shaw ends up setting up a patrol. They're trying to catch drunk drivers because it's a holiday weekend and got people coming in and, you know that people are going to be doing silly things like drinking while driving. They caught a couple people. We can talk about that a little later. But they find the guy, and they find the car that they're looking for. So they get him, and they bring him for questioning. And this is where it kind of gets interesting, because he doesn't want to talk.
Right.
And it's at this point, I'm thinking he's not talking because he has something to hide.
Yeah.
Exactly. What were you guys? Is that where we all were at that point?
I usually thought, because usually criminals who don't talk right away usually have something to hide, or they're somewhat guilty in whatever they're being accused of.
I thought he was guilty. Or at least I thought that he knew, you know, who was, you know, like, person. We get, like, we find out at the end, not to, like, go forward, but we do find out at the end who it was. But I actually thought that he had something to do with it.
Yeah, because they say that he has this huge rap sheet and that he was ex-gang member, or they weren't really sure if he was still in it or not, but he had been out of town for a while. His cousin had, like, super clean rap sheet, you know, model student, nice boy, never does anything wrong, which clearly he does. But they said that he had a beef with the Jameson guys, and that was their name, right? Jameson? Jameson guys. I'm thinking of the alcohol Jameson right now.
Let me know where your mind is at.
Hey, it's Thursday night. Thirsty Thursday, anyone? So that leads them to Shea Bishop, because him and Shea, Cesar and Shea, clearly had some sort of beef in the past where those two had gotten into it a bunch of times. So
right.
that mm-hmm. leads everyone to kind of go down that route.
And they also mentioned, because Cesar kept saying that he had a dark past, but he's now clean, mm-hmm. he's made a new life. And then they were also talking that the people who tried to shoot him actually end up being, you know, this because they did blood oaths and whatnot. So it's his own people that are trying to get back at him.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Which is kind of sad, but that's kind of like the gang life. You know, once you're yeah. in, you're in, for, in life. For life.
And you have a hard, you can't get out. Like, you know, you get out, you're in a body bag.
And it was interesting because at one point he did say, you know, I did everything they asked me to do to let me go.
Right.
Mm-hmm. And so was it that he was allowed to go, but he wasn't supposed to ever come back? And that's when they could mess with him? Or was this their way of kind of trying to lure him back because they let him go thinking he was scot-free and then actually he wasn't?
Yeah, I think it was the latter that, you know, he still kind of had ties. Maybe he was talking to other people on the side and they found out about it. And he kind of came back. He was forced back a little bit.
Yeah, through his cousin.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Cindy, what do you think about all this?
I didn't really think, going backtracking a little bit, I didn't think he was guilty because it would have been way too easy.
Mm-hmm.
So I did definitely think it was a setup in some way, shape, or form, but I didn't really expect it to turn out the way it did. But coming for, like, the ties or whatever, I don't know. I guess that would make sense. I think he was ambushed back in, definitely. They decided they probably just changed their mind, saying, you know what, we're not going to let you off the hook that easy. And so they wanted to wrap things up permanently with him.
Mm-hmm.
Well said.
Yeah, mm-hmm. Very well said. Let's get down to it. I mean, this is the ending part of it. You know, it turns out that his cousin had been texting the gang members, you know, oh, he's back in town. Mm-hmm. Oh, this is what we're doing. Yep. We're going to the park. And his cousin completely set him up. And even after he finds out that his cousin set him up, he was still hesitant and still didn't want to give up the guys mm-hmm. who he knew killed him, because he still wanted to go after them for himself. So it's kind of that, I guess it's not really loyalty at this point, but it's that mentality of, you know, this is my mess, I need to handle it because mm-hmm. they are really after mm-hmm. me. And
yeah, and I thought it was interesting how he was still defending his cousin, because yes, we heard that his cousin had a clean rap sheet, so maybe that's the cousin that he still knew and believed was still right. in existence.
Mm-hmm.
And then once he found out that his cousin set him up, he still can't believe it, because, yeah. like, no, he's a good person. He would never do this to me.
Yeah, I agree.
So I think that's why he was defending him. And then once he kind of had the realization that his cousin did set him up, he was like, all right, these are the people that you're going to need.
Yeah, and it took a lot of convincing from Swarek to...
Well, because Swarek was like, what did you do to get into the gang? You mm-hmm. know, how old were you? And he's like, I was 14. And then he's like, what did you do to get into the gang? And then he remembered, okay, then, you know, he probably killed somebody
yeah.
to get into the gang, or severely, you know? Mm-hmm. And then so now he sees where his cousin...
Yeah, and he was probably a good kid before mm-hmm. he got into the gang. I just realized that this episode dealt a lot with the 14, 15-year-old circle there. There's a lot of teenagers in this episode.
I think that's a nice change, because the other episodes we've dealt with are mostly just about the adults, mm-hmm. and now they're bringing in the younger perspective, the younger characters that we can kind of, you know, get attached to and, yeah. like, learn about their storylines besides just, you know, adults the whole time.
Yeah, I like the change of pace. I thought this episode, you know, we've been talking about in the past how they've been a little slow to get started, but mm-hmm. I thought this one was definitely, you know, a lot more crime heavy
mm-hmm.
than the past ones, and so I liked it a little bit more. And even within the crime story, we got a lot of insight and background still to our main characters.
I like that there was two different crime stories.
Yeah.
Not just like one. You know, we saw Swarek do his thing, and then we saw, you know, the cops' uniforms do theirs. So I mm-hmm. thought it was a good balance.
Yeah, it definitely was. And speaking of that other crime, I loved this. Well, is it wrong that I love the Alex storyline?
No, I think it's
because it was
these
so
stories
sad.
Happen so much in, you know, everyday life. Yeah. Mm-hmm. But teenagers always questioning who they are and their sexuality and whatnot. I think this topic, like, really hit home for a lot of people, I'm sure. You know, this is an issue that is prevalent in today's mm-hmm. society. Mm-hmm. And I think any teenager who's going through this should definitely watch this episode.
Yeah, it definitely brought a lot of insight. And, you know, it was very positive towards the end. You know, it does get better. Andy's telling him, I'm not going to jump ahead like that. So Gail and Andy, while we're at the DUI checkpoint, I guess you could call it, a gold sedan, they pull it over and he just takes off driving. So they chase him down.
I'm sorry, I don't mean to interrupt.
Oh, yeah.
Really quick question. What happened with the woman?
Oh, yeah, the woman that they pulled over
Put her in a cell, and then we didn't see her the rest of the time.
Her
what was the point of that?
They called the lawyer, and that was it. And she's...
Yeah, it's a holiday weekend,
Yeah, she probably just got stuck in there for a few days, and then her lawyer came.
She got stuck there for the
weekend. Just write her up for a DUI, and that's
like one thing that kind of, like, annoys me sometimes when it comes to this show, is that they'll start... a story. I mean, not saying that's a storyline or anything per se, but they'll like start something and they won't finish it.
You know, because while we're on that, the reason I felt like she was there was to get us talking with Epstein and Cruz to see how concerned he was about her being back on the job so soon.
Mm-hmm.
And she kind of served her purpose for that, because, you know, they're booking her because they're booking that day, and that's when he can be like, oh, so, you know, what you eat today, you know, are you eating, are you sleeping? And she was just kind of the filler to get him to ask her those questions, so that by the end of the episode she could say, like, no, I really am having a problem. And
that was just the starting point of their conversation, their storyline.
If she's having trouble sleeping, why doesn't Sam know, and why isn't he doing anything about his girlfriend not sleeping?
Maybe she's not telling him.
He's a detective.
He would pick up on this, but maybe he's just being a guy. Little aloof right now.
No offense.
She said it.
Cindy, what do you think?
Kind of agree.
Whatever. Whatever. All right, speaking of guys, let's get back to Alex. We find Alex, this poor teenage boy, locked up in the trunk of this car that Teddy had been driving, who we find out later on. And Gail and Andy are taking him in. He's like, oh, I'm an orphan, like Batman. And, you know, not giving them any information. And then he starts this major nosebleed, which at this point I'm thinking maybe
he's on drugs or something.
Yeah, that's or something like that. But it turns out it was a concussion because he had been thrown against the wall.
Beaten up.
Yeah.
And while we're at the hospital... awkward moment of the night. Andy runs into Sam's ex-girlfriend.
Yes, Monica.
Yes. Talk about having a bad day. She's already walked up into work while Sam and Cruz are walking in together and being all couple-y. Awkwardly bumps into him as they're leaving their meeting, and then runs into the ex-girlfriend, who she now has to explain, actually, we're not together anymore. Yeah. But they're still really good friends.
Yeah, and then she's like, oh, I've heard that before. Just to, you know, put more salt on that wound.
Yeah. That's gotta be one of the worst situations.
That was kind of just like, that's really.
I did like the line that Andy, like, quickly said, but it's like, we're not together anymore, so I don't have any more say on his clothing. Yeah. That was great.
Especially since earlier she was like, oh, that's a nice shirt you're wearing. And
yep.
Clearly,
I was like the way she said it too, because she said it really fast. She was like mumbled, so like she wouldn't like notice.
Yeah, sad. So Alex tells them when we find out during the exam that Alex is actually a girl.
Which I think we all kind of figured that out a little bit,
because there was just something about Alex that you could just look at him. Tell that, you know, maybe, I mean, you're too pretty to be a boy. There's just something so delicate about the facial features that...
Very feminine.
Yeah, very feminine. So they call in Nash, and Alex's parents have kicked him out because of the way that he dresses, and they thought it was just a phase. And then he comes out here to see his ex-girlfriend, whose name I'm slipping up on right now.
Oh, yeah.
Teddy?
Oh my goodness. We're all just
goodness.
Like, Heather.
Heather.
Is it Heather?
No, I'm I honestly didn't write down the name. I didn't catch it.
I thought I had it in my notes.
Let us know.
Let us know, please.
Let us know.
Yes.
Give us a tweet or something to let us know.
Go to iTunes. Leave a comment.
Leave a comment.
And while you're there, rate us.
Yes.
Five stars.
When you
we like fives.
We do like fives. Tell us what you like, what you don't like, what we can do better. We're a brand new show here at AfterBuzz, so the more you guys give us, the more we can give back to you.
Yeah, so, and tell a friend.
Tell two friends. Marisa told
friends.
A friend.
I told a friend, and look at that.
Even brought her in studio, so we can all do the same.
I did my job. You guys got to do yours.
So Alex came out here to visit his ex-girlfriend because they broke up, and it was heartbreaking, and been
he
kicked out.
Why.
He didn't know why she broke up with him. Her brother, Teddy, walks in on them making out or something and gets super pissed. Starts, you know, yanks Alex off of her, throws Alex against a wall, throws him in the trunk, and that's when we found them. This storyline, it's a great storyline, but it was kind of intense and a little bit, it was really serious because it's such a serious issue. Mm-hmm. So
I really liked this kind of storyline because I feel like tonight's two cases really dealt on the emotional side of investigation, where the previous episodes of this season is more like crimes and evidence and very procedural crimes and, you know, that type of drama. And then this felt like the emotional drama that we all love of just this personal storylines and how we get attached to people more so than the procedural aspect of it.
I mean, I think it hits home, too, for a lot of people. You know, how many people have been bullied and, you know, still get bullied, even though they're adults.
Yeah.
You know, whether it's, you know, being backstabbed or, you know, something along those lines. I think it hits home. And I think at least, you know, the majority of the people can somewhat relate, not in the same situation as what Alex went through, but like being bullied in some type of way.
And the fact that it happened in a major city, because Alex says, you know, I'm from some little town that you've never heard of.
Exactly.
So you think most of the time when you move into like a big city, there's more acceptance and, you know, people just understand more. And then does still have this happen with Teddy getting all crazy, and they go to talk to Teddy at his house and he tries to run again. And dude, just stop running, because once you run, the cops know you've done something.
Yeah.
You're guilty.
I just thought it was weird that the brother, Teddy, kept referring to Alex as like a freak of nature or some other thing. And I don't even know if they actually realized that he was a girl, if that was part of it. Because when he caught with his sister or something like that. So I don't know. I thought that was kind of weird.
He did kept saying that. That was really bugging me.
Kind of confusing, too. Did he know that?
They never really brought it up if they actually knew that he was a girl.
Did she know?
No, I don't know.
They talked about that because the girl mentioned that she started making out with Alex, and then from that she realized that Alex is actually a girl who's a boy now, and I think that that was the same time her brother found out, too, and he flipped.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, so the sister was more understanding.
Yeah, and the brother was not. But I loved how Andy just threw that lawn chair to catch him. That was awesome. Yes, way to be innovative.
At first, I wasn't sure where she was standing versus where he was, so I thought she was about to just plow that thing in his face.
I know.
And around the corner. It's like, can cops do that? And then she went for the leg, so I guess, you know, that's more cop-friendly.
Pretty good.
So Alex escapes while he's meeting with the social worker. So now it's like Operation Find Alex again.
Yep.
And the sister, whose name, I'm sorry, I still cannot remember, you know, she's not any help, really. They're trying to see, you know, like, hey, did he mention anywhere? Is he staying at a hotel, a motel, anything? Finally, they get a phone call on her phone, and Andy answers it because she won't. Mm-hmm. And he's basically saying his final goodbyes.
Yeah.
And it's like, wow, how are we going to find him?
And, I thought that was interesting how Andy was just a little bit reckless again, not really thinking, because if had Alex answered the phone, the girl would have been more acceptable to talk to Andy and more receptive to that. And then Andy just answers it. And I'm surprised that Alex didn't just, like, hang up, be like, oh, no, you're not the one I wanted to talk to.
I was actually had the opposite feeling because I felt like Alex and Andy had a good connection while they were talking earlier, that I thought that there was this kind of rapport between them where maybe he would be trusting of her. But I mean, once you're in a state of, you know, he clearly was going to commit suicide. So once you're in that state of mind, maybe you're not thinking as straight. But I was I was just thinking like, OK, yeah, he'll talk to Andy. She'll be like the calmer down person, you know, like the negotiator in the situation, because it's someone who he knows and trusts. But obviously that didn't work.
Oh, right.
So Andy keeps calling and uses the cell phone to get text Alex and say, hey, I need to talk to you, like video message me. So throughout the whole video message, though,
FaceTime.
Throughout that whole thing, though, Alex was still addressing Andy, saying his final goodbyes to the girl instead of having the conversation Andy was trying to have.
Which I thought that was interesting, why Alex was saying his last goodbyes to Andy and not the girl.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I'm like, why?
I mean, but he was in the process of passing out, though. Yeah. I think he was actually illusional. He wasn't quite reality at that point. I think he either had already was bleeding out or whatnot, but that's what I noticed, too, because he got, like, his eyes would roll back or he would, like, sway back and forth, try and catch his balance.
I also noticed this is kind of, like, I don't want to say, like, off topic, but don't you need, like, Wi-Fi for FaceTime?
You need internet. You don't need
But you need internet, right?
Yeah, internet, but, you know, cell phone plans, you can have internet internet packages.
Oh, yeah, if you have,
whatnot.
Like, the 4G plan.
Oh, okay.
Fancy people. I don't got that 4G.
I was just, I have an iPhone. So.
I mean, I have an iPhone. I always have to use internet. So for FaceTime, that's why I was just like, that's a little odd. But it's a show, so. No, but I actually agree with you. Because I was like seeing him kind of like, you know, the eyes are rolling back and he's kind of like looking a little bit like on the faint side.
Yeah.
Yeah. So that's why I was just kind of like, well, you know, he's just saying goodbye right now to anybody because he's about to die.
Okay.
So of course Andy and Gail are able to figure out where he is and get there in the nick of time to call the ambulance and save him. And then Andy in the hospital room, you know, is talking to Alex and saying how, you know, that the world is a better place with him in it and we need more people like him. And again, it was one of those points where I was like, Andy, is this a little too over the line for you to be crossing? Because you're getting very attached to this one person in this one case, which we know that she has the habit of doing. So what did you guys think about that? Because, I mean, it was a nice speech and it was appropriate, but at the same time, it was a little bit out of her jurisdiction as a cop.
I think as a cop, you're supposed to say the right things to people in times of distraught. But I think this whole conversation kind of had a double meaning, that Andy wanted to talk to Alex about his life, and she was also talking about herself and her relationship with Sam. And, you know, because at the beginning she was saying, you know, she's trying to get over Sam and whatnot. So this was just, like, her way of also dealing with moving on, and life is going to get better for her as well.
I think it was just a basic Andy move.
I just loved your facial expression after that.
No, but I agree with Marisa. And then I just think that she's, like, getting, because you said, like, is it, like, part of her jurisdiction, you know, that she goes a little bit, you know, too far. I think that's who Andy is, though. You know, like we've talked about, like, previous episodes, that's who she is. She, like, she leads with her emotion before she leads, you know, with anything else. So I think that's what I mean by saying it's kind of like an Andy move, typical, you know, Andy because it's, that's who she is.
I agree.
Yeah.
But I think also someone who, you know, attempted, you know, being with doing suicide or whatnot, they want to hear that, you know, they need to be around, that it's actually good that they're still here. They need that acceptance so they won't try it again. So that could have been another reason why Andy did that Andy move that you referenced to. because she wanted to assure Alex that, you know what, it's actually a good thing you're still here. You know, people need to learn to accept other people, and could have been something for a greater good.
Yeah, and she also said the line that the world is a better place because you're in it.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So just reinforcing that positive message to Alex.
Yeah, and maybe the world needs more Andy cops to be there. Because, I mean, she even, when the rest of the group was like, all right, you know, shift's over, let's start moving, let's go on our camping trip. She was like, no, I'm going to stay here, make sure they're okay, because at that point, neither set of kids had parents there to watch after them. They were just going to be at the hospital by themselves, you know. So maybe sometimes being Andy isn't quite so bad.
Right.
Of a cop to be.
She's a good person.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Just sometimes it gets in the way of her cop
her duties. Job.
Yeah. Just sometimes it gets in the way of being a cop. So let's talk about this whole camping trip.
Huh?
The annual camping trip. I love Gail in the beginning of this episode because I am Gail. Camping, wilderness, no. Four-star hotel? Okay. That's like camping to me.
Really? I'm kind of surprised. I figured you'd be the person who would actually enjoy that.
No.
Maybe I'm wrong.
I used to cry. Girl Scout trips, I'd cry until my parents came and got me. But I love that she came with her big bag, and everyone was like, you get like one bag, not five.
She's got like a suitcase, yes, like hair products. Like,
I claim ignorance. yes, you understand me, Gail. This is the one time that I've ever been on like complete and total team Gail in my life.
I liked how they're having this another episode where they're all together, because I feel like these episodes so far, it's always like in groups. Mm-hmm. We haven't really seen them bond together in the friendship aspect. They're always together working, but not on a personal lives.
Yeah.
I mean, we
yeah.
see them at the Black Penny, but that's just at the end of their shift. That's not really having fun or, you know, bonding.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. It's good to see that they're, you know, the rookies, you know, they started as rookies together. I think that was mentioned in the episode tonight by Nick. You know, they all came up together, so he's still not really a part of the inside clique that they have going on because they've been through so much already before he got there.
I love how he has to pay every time he says Afghanistan.
Oh my god.
The Afghanistan.
There's awesome. A lot of quarters in there, too. It's almost like the douchebag jar on New Girl.
Yes. I know exactly what you're talking about.
That's what that reminded me of. But I mean, I think that it was great to see them all together. It kind of sucks that Diaz is being the good guy by, you know, he can't go because he doesn't want to leave Denise. Their kid is allergic to everything except for cats. Isn't cats like the one thing everyone's allergic to? How are you allergic to everything except cats? How does that work out?
So it makes me think that maybe he just wants to be with his kid. It's just an excuse to get out of the camping trip. He's a father now.
I'm just tired of hearing him talk about it. Honestly, because it's like every single, it's like, shut up.
Yeah, but it was kind of, I mean, you could tell that he was a little desperate because, you know, the whole episode, he's like, hey, Shaw, you and the wife and girl should come over. Like, how's your relationship going? What's going on here? You know, let's do something together. Like, I'm really trying here. And just everything I do, nothing's working.
Yeah, and Denise is not happy. They're not happy in that relationship. And you even saw that in, like, the first episode this season that you knew that things weren't going right. And it's still not going right, but Diaz is the kind of person who will stick to the end and make sure, you know, he'll try everything he can before he'll, you know, just give up.
Yeah, and Shaw even told him, you know, to stick it out. But when Shaw said that, I kind of had mixed emotions about it because Shaw's so unhappy in his relationship, and clearly his children were affected by it. You know, like blue hair, episodes with cops, you know, all that stuff. It's like, why would you? Sometimes it might be better for a kid to have your parents happy as individuals as opposed to miserable as a couple.
That's why he kind of said either stick it out or just let it fall apart.
Yeah.
So I don't know if he's just, I think he's trying to give him his two cents, but at the same time, he doesn't want to tell him what to do. type of thing.
Yeah.
You know, but I don't know.
I did like this conversation because it shows like two fathers with kids at different ages, you know, how they're trying to handle their own kids and their own relationships. So they were just bonding in that way.
Yeah. And then I liked how, you know, at the end of the episode, Shaw kind of tells Epstein, hey, you know, back off him, because even you said he's going to do the right thing no matter what. So as his bestie, you should.
As his bestie.
I mean, they're besties.
I know.
Yeah. You know, he's acting out because his bestie's going to leave him. So he doesn't want that to happen. So what do? You act out and you act all angry and mad and till you get your way. It's not working, though.
Yeah. No.
And so in that spirit, he decides, hey, let's cancel the trip because no one actually wants to go camping anyway. Mm-hmm. And so they have a camp out on the roof of the apartment building, which was really nice because it brought everyone together again. And this time, what's his face? Diaz was able to bring Denise and his child, you know, and it gave everyone a chance to kind of get to know her and get to mingle with her a little
bit. And he's not allergic to the roof, so that's a good thing.
Hopefully.
No.
I don't know. Well,
we don't know.
Hope they have
he could have an allergic reaction.
Yeah, to anything. The organic beer.
I thought it was weird that he's allergic to everything, but he got, like, a Sunny D, like, handed to the kid. And I was like, isn't that, like, sugar and I don't even know what else in there.
Oranges. A lot of people are allergic to orange.
Citrus, which, you know, is bad for your stomach or...
Yeah.
It's like, okay, yeah. Okay, that's allergic to everything. Here's a Sunny D. There you go.
So much sugar. And so then the other thing that's happening at this party is Gail and Chloe kind of have a heart-to-heart, I guess you could say, because Nick decided to invite her after being partnered with her all day and kind of letting it slip a story. You know, his favorite moment with Andy undercover was watching French films on mute and dubbing it themselves and the look of just, like, pure happiness and joy on his face. And you're like, aw, you're in love. Yeah. You want to marry her. Have her baby. And so, you know, Chloe, I love Chloe. She was just like,
so do I.
I thought it was going to be a cop moment, you know, maybe something that you guys did in action, not something on your free time. So then he invites her to the party and she's like, hi, Gail. I just want to be your friend. Like, I don't know what I did to you. And Gail, being typical Gail, comes at her and is just like, I don't like you.
Saying how pathetic she is
over the dove thing. And the whole time she was talking, I was just looking behind her on those stairs. Yeah. And I was like, girl, you better watch your mouth because this girl's going to blow your head off.
Better watch your back, too.
Yes.
And call karma, people. Yeah. Karma.
And that's exactly what she does. Chloe just drops the bomb. Like, at least my boyfriend's not falling for Andy.
Oh, I love that. That was the best line out of the whole show.
Was so her face, too, was just like, no, you did not just go there. Yeah, that happened.
And then Gail turns and sees them, and that just, like... angry
fire in the eyes.
I was surprised laser beams didn't start coming out and killing people. That was a great look. I wish I could give that look because I would get everything that I ever wanted. Think about it. If you could throw a look like that, people would just stop and be like, oh, I'm sorry, no, you're right here.
The stink
here.
Eye.
Yeah,
the stink eye.
That'd stink be good. Eye, man. So,
but I love how Chloe was the one who just dropped that because it's so typical Chloe. This is so true to her character. If someone else had delivered that news, it wouldn't have hit as hard as it did with Chloe.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I love Chloe. We're like this. Because that's something I would do.
Well,
she just says things with no filter, just the way it is. And kind of like Gail, but Gail's kind of mean about it. She doesn't really have tact, but Chloe just says it in a way, but she didn't mean it to be in a bad or good or anything like
Chloe
that.
Chloe reminds me of a child's innocence, where a child's going to keep it real with you and tell you the truth about something. And they don't mean to hurt your feelings, but, you know, it's like, oh, hey, sweetie, is mommy pretty? No, that outfit makes you look fat. And it's not, like, in a mean or malicious way. It's just, you know, you ask their opinion, and someone like Chloe's going to give it to you, and she doesn't realize that, you know,
I don't know. I felt like this moment she kind of flipped that switch and just got that sassiness to her, like, all right, you're going to be mean. Here's, like, I'm going to drop this on your lap and you're just going to, like, have to take it. So.
Yeah. I got that. Kind
of,
yeah.
Yeah, kind of her way of being mean back.
Mm-hmm. Her way of being mean back. Mm-hmm. I think it was done on purpose, but still in, like, that Chloe, like, maybe doesn't realize exactly what she's doing, but just saying something that she's observed. Because, I mean, she has no proof of the matter. She just has what she believes is happening.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Or what we all know is happening.
Yeah, what we all know is happening. When the episode started tonight, I thought it was a flashback because it was just Andy and Nick in the, like, conversating in the kitchen. That's not a word, I know. Conversing in the kitchen. And I thought it was a flashback to when they were undercover. And I was like, oh my gosh, we're going to see them,
like,
cross the line right now. So who knows? Maybe we'll see something like that later.
I sure hope so.
But if you guys don't have anything else to add.
Other than this episode really picked up the season, I think.
Yeah.
Because the first three were still kind of getting in the groove, especially with the hiatuses that we've been on. But this episode, like, really turned it up.
Yeah. I even liked how there was a slight reference to the two-week hiatus that we've had because, you know, Cruz,
Cruz been gone for 2 weeks
ago when she shot someone and they died.
Yeah.
So, you know, at least they know. So maybe now that we have the rest of the season all laid out in front of us, it will be rolling a little quicker.
And yes, it's nonstop from here until September 12th. So, yay.
Woo-woo.
Awesome.
Let's get into some news and gossips. Nope.
And no.
AfterBuzz TV. I hit the button. Soundboard fail. I'm sorry, Marissa. That's it.
Do the TriCaster. What? All right. Well, news.
There we go.
There we go. All right. So, according to Zaptuit, Ben Bass, who plays Sam, as we all know, he mentioned that Swarek, that ship with Andy and Sam, is really complicated. According to him, he said, if Sam knew that Andy wanted to be with him and it wasn't a question of him pouring his heart out to her and then her just going off for 6 months, I think he'd probably be willing to wait for her as long as he had to. So it just shows that Sam...
So he's saying because Andy didn't put out there that she was interested as well, that's why he took the six-month absence as... Okay, I can move on.
Yep, exactly.
I still don't like it.
Nah, I don't like it either. I like them two together. So, but we didn't really see Sam and Marlo together tonight either. So that was kind of refreshing because we usually see them interact a few times. But I didn't even see them together.
We just saw them the one time when they were walking in the building, and that wasn't even.
Yeah, and that was nothing.
Yeah, so. That was the back of the heads.
Yeah, and then I also looked up on ABC.com for The Rookie Blue, and there was Chloe, the actress who plays Chloe. I don't remember her name off the top of my head. She, when she started off, she said that Charlotte Sullivan, who plays Gail, had emailed her like a week before she came to Toronto to shoot Rookie Blue. She said that Charlotte has sent her a nice email welcoming her to the Rookie Blue family and getting to know each other in that way. And then she said her first day of filming that Greg, who plays Dove. He really helped her in her filming of the scenes and, you know, how they interacted in the cop car. That was her first day of shooting. So she said it was a really nice, welcoming experience from all the Rookie Blue cast members.
I love my fellow Canadians.
I thought that was sweet.
Yeah, I love that Charlotte was nice to her in an email because she knew she had to be, like, a full bitch on set, like, in character. Like, hey, I'm a really nice person.
In
I can't
real
wait
life.
To meet you.
Yeah.
I'm about to be a raging bitch. To you right now,
but you know that's comforting to know that she is really I hope all of them are really nice people. I'm sure they are in real life, so it they are just characters in the end.
That's awesome.
So one big happy family, it seems like.
Awesome. All right, let's do some predictions.
We knew, and now you're after Buzz TV predictions.
I just feel like I'm in the Twilight Zone.
I know. That's why I do my squiggly eyes. Like, Wayne's World.
Who wants to start with their predictions tonight?
I'll go. I think, wow. Let me see. I think that the whole Gail and Andy is going to blow up. Mm. Andy's going to end up, okay, this is my thing. Andy's going to end up kind of falling for Nick more, because we all know she's like, you know, falling. We all know that they like each other. So they're going to have like a little triangle. And then Swarek is going to realize how much he misses Andy and sees her with somebody else. And he's going to be like, oh, hey, I want to be with you. I love you.
I like those.
I love the whole Chloe and Dove
thing. He needs to just stop fighting it. I know. Because that boy likes that crazy girl, too.
And of course,
they would be great together. Yeah. They are so alike. Yeah. It's kind of freaky.
Every guy needs a little crazy in their life.
Yeah.
And of course, Diaz, that kid is not his.
We're gonna keep saying that every week until
we're vindicated.
until it comes true.
Those are my predictions.
I think because we see for next week's episode that there's this big heroin case that they have that's gonna go down, so it's gonna be another drug bust kind of procedural episode, which I think I like that. Mm-hmm. Like I like them in the action, the nitty gritty. I think with Andy. Yes, she and Nick are going to get closer, just a little bit more. And I'm still hoping for a flashback of what happened in those 6 months that we did not see.
I think we all do.
Yeah, but I want a visual reinforcement of what happened.
I want to see the movie
Your word
scenes.
Is not good enough. I got to see this.
You want to see the movie scene.
Yeah, I want to see the goods. I'm just going to say that. So, all right.
Cindy.
I have to agree. I don't think the kid's going to be his. There's probably going to be a really crappy story to that, though. Either, like, something happened or, I don't even know. Like, I don't know how to put it into words. But the whole thing with Chloe and Doug, or is it Doug or Dove?
Dove.
I agree. I think he definitely likes her. But in the same time, Chloe reminds me of what Dove was like in the very first season.
Yes! That's what I said.
Yeah. Which is why I think it's so funny that he, like, thinks that he drives her, or like she drives him crazy. I'm like, that was literally you in season one, though. We're always talking about useless information that no one really cared about. So,
yep,
you're the annoying rookie.
Exactly,
you were a rookie. So, all right, so my predictions, because I love everyone else's, I think that either during or after next week's episode with this whole drug bust coming back in, I see Nick and Andy having to go back undercover. Officer is back next week, so maybe they have to do something again where it's like, hey, we need you guys to go back as these people to bust some people who are in line with this. So then maybe that's when the magic will really happen. Mm-hmm. And it'll send Gail into a frenzy because now she's aware that her boyfriend's falling for her.
Yeah. Oh, that's really good because they already know what it's like to be undercover and they have that relationship already set. Oh, that'd be juicy.
Yeah. Maybe Gail will break up with Nick right before he goes undercover, so then it's like they're both single. Anyways, let us know. I'm on one right now. All right, let us know what you guys think. Where can they find you guys throughout the week to keep the conversation going?
I am Anik Dufour, and you can find me on Twitter and Instagram at JustAnik and my website, AnikDufour.com.
And you can follow me on Twitter and on Instagram at SerafiniTV.
Cindy, you want to give yourself a plug?
You can follow me at NAVC1409 on Twitter.
Thank you for joining us.
Thank you. Join the show.
Come visit LA often so you can come back.
I'll try as soon as my paycheck allows me to.
And I'm Tiona Hobson, and you can find me at TweetT22. We will see you guys next week because there's no more breaks in the season.
Woo-hoo! Yes.
So until then, Rookie Bluers, we're out.
From Bing.com, executive producers Maria Menounos, Kevin Undergaro, Phil Svitek, and the entire AfterBuzz TV staff, we would like to thank you for listening to the AfterBuzz TV network. To watch or listen to other after shows and post comments or questions, be sure to visit AfterBuzzTV.com. I'm Sir Richard Wentworth, and this has been a presentation of AfterBuzz TV.
Buzz you later!
The views expressed herein are those of the hosts only and do not necessarily reflect the views of AfterBuzz TV or its owners or principals.